much for a nice introduction. I'm actually surprised that so many people came. I thought nobody came, so I can just turn around and go back, you know, because I really don't like my to talk about books, you know, and things like that, you know, is published and people then have to either read, you know, or not to read and to give their own opinion and so on. So this is not a really session to boost the sales, you know, this is a government printing office publication, okay, so I will just try maybe to explain you the way I did the book, you know, what I used, you know, what resources, you know, and then maybe having some main events, you know, from each of these three major fleet versus fleet operations, you know, and then we hopefully we will have some questions and answers, you know. I don't like to talk more than 30, 40 minutes. I don't like to listen to my foreign accent, you know, so I don't want to bore you, you know, okay. So this is a what I call scheduled events, you know, what I will try to talk about, you know. Those of you who are not familiar with operational art, you know, we pay great deal of attention to certain definitions, you know, but this is the one thing which the U.S. Navy still today doesn't really get this thing straight in doctrine, you know, and thinking. The joint doctrine provides good publication, Army and Marines, but the Navy and the Air Force are still behind, you know. But we have done. Actually, the reason I'm, you know, talking about this today is we have done these things, you know. It was not at that time called major naval operation. It was called Battle of Midway or Battle of Coral Sea, you know, Battle of the Philippine Sea, but really amounts to what we call major operations. The major operations are, you know, consist of the number of the strikes, attacks, and minor and major tactical actions, you know, and aim is to achieve some operational objective, you know, which is a part of the higher theater strategic or military strategic objective. And there's always one commander, you know, and there's always what we call operational idea, or in modern terms, concepts of operations, okay? Okay. Okay. And I have the types, you know, so what I will talk today is really fleet versus fleet. And these are three selected major operations from the Pacific War. There was another one, Battle for Leyte, which I didn't include because I wrote a book about that, so I didn't want to include in the book. Okay, so these operations are not very conducted very often. They are rare, but they are very extremely important because they result in major victories, which very often also you know, signifies the change of phase in the war or campaign, you know, and so on. So they're very important, you know. Okay. This is the way I have organized these things. More or less, you know, each chapter follows essentially the same, you know, pattern. I always provide, you know, strategic setting. That means providing broader picture of the situation at that particular time. And then I talk about operating area because I think is one important thing is to, especially for naval warfare, to know the physical environment, you know, the geometry of the theater, the basis, you know, and so on, weather, climate, things like that. And then I have organization, you know, and then I have always what the commanders knew at that time. I think a common error very often is to analyze decisions made by various commanders in retrospect. But, you know, most important thing, this is nothing new. You have to see what they knew at that time, and then only then you can actually, you know, either, you know, criticize or approve a certain course of action they had taken, you know, okay? And then in execution, you know, and then I think one thing which I try always to do in this kind of studies, the reading of history, you know, writing of history without trying to learn something, you know, maybe term lessons learned is not proper. Some people will say lessons identified. Either way, we have to try to learn some lessons which are valid for today and for some time in the future. And when you look at the operational level, the major operational campaigns, these lessons are more durable. They're even valid today. Certainly tactical lessons or any of these major operations, they're all gone. They're all, you know, weapons and procedures change, you know, they're not really relevant today. Okay, I cannot change anything here. Restarting, you know. Okay. So I have selected, you know, the certain things, you know, here for today. And one thing which I paid great deal of attention, you know, is to get documents which were our radio intercepts, you know, in the Pacific War. And that's the really one good, excellent source to know why the commanders made decisions they made. And without knowing this, you really cannot evaluate properly, and they cannot judge. So this is what shows here is the organization. Washington, D.C., we have a Navy radio intelligence section, that's a OP 20G, open up, the CNO office. Then it was a security section, that was one station called NEGAT, that was used in the dispatches. That's the Office of Naval Communication. Then in Pacific area, we have a SINCPAC Fleet Intelligence Center, and there was, as you know, Lieutenant Commander Edwin Layton, an excellent officer. And then we have Fleet Radio Unit Pacific, you know, HYPO. Mm-hmm. HYPO H stands for Hawaii, and that was a Joseph Rochefort. And then we have a station cast in Cavite until, I think, April 1942. And then we have a Belconnen, that's nearby Canberra. And then was the Allied Fleet Radio Unit, Melbourne, Frumel. Okay. And then, you know, these are some of the documents which were produced daily, and they were distributed to the major subordinate commanders, all task force commanders, you know, they got all these documents, you know. Later on, I didn't include here, there was one bulletin issued by JICPOA, Joint Intelligence Center Pacific Area, which was excellent, you know. And I have some things to show you. We might take a look. I have here the CNO summaries of radio intelligence for April, June, that's for Midway. And you might take a look, you know, to what extent, you know, our analysts were really doing a great job here. Okay. Yes, yeah, you can pass if you're not interested. And this is Edwin Layton collection from Naval War College here. Okay, so you might take a look, you know, I'm not asking to write, but we can see just, I have a here copy. Okay, I made a copy. Okay, this is the, in terms of the, as you know, the Japanese code books, GN-25 code book. And that was focus of work on NEGAT, that was in Washington, and CAST, Cavite, and then later Belconnen, you know, in Australia. And then this was one critical, flag officer's code, that was focus on HYPO, and that's where Joseph Rochefort was working, okay. And then you have a naval code book D, which was supposed to be changed in early May. It was until 27 May. That caused a lot of problems for us between 27 May and 5th June. We didn't almost know anything what was going on Japanese side. But we collected enough evidence of their intentions, you know, before that. That was preliminary to the Battle of Midway. Okay. That's this what I already go over. This. Okay, you might not take a look, but they have all here, all details on Aleutian phase, you know, Midway phase, all the summaries of what the Japanese were planning to do. Okay, that gives you the answer why we have been so successful, you know, okay? With small forces, we are able to timely to concentrate our forces, you know, on the proper place, proper time. But one thing which is, as you know, is the story is very complex. You have this excellent officer, Ed Layton, and he was working very closely with Joe Rochefort in Hawaii. But Rochefort has major problems because he had a lot of enemies, really, in Washington. Brother Redman, you know, one of them was Rear Admiral, who actually were opposing to many of his assessments. In the end, you know, he prevailed, but later, after Battle of Midway, he was replaced. He was, essentially demoted, you know, went to be a commander of the floating dock. And only after his death, you know, his contribution was actually recognized, you know, but was also an excellent officer, you know, okay? So that's just one day. That was the constant stream of messages which were sent to the subordinate commanders. So we have been excellently prepared, you know, and we knew almost everything or any substance, you know, on the Japanese side, okay? As you know, time doesn't really, I have been following this day by day for each of these battles, you know, and you will be amazed how much notion, you know, in addition to the radio intercepted comment, you know, we have certainly search planes, you know, they have submarines, we have some human, you know, in the Philippines and so on, but by and large, most of the decisions are based on the radio intercepts. As you know, problem with radio intercepts would, you know, if Japanese were not so dogmatic, you know, and believing that their codes are unbreakable, that would actually open us also for the, to be fed with misleading information. So it was, you know, the fact is that Japanese never, never believed that their codes are broken. The same thing happened in the European theater with the German Ultra, okay? And this is one I try to show you just, there are many, each of the major operations ends with the conclusions, and the operationists learned that the way I did this, you know, it was always, writing the conclusion based on the particular event, and then in italics, you know, I will say draw certain lessons learned. You know, you might agree or disagree with that, you know, so on, but I think, you know, the way to do it, you know, is there are two ways. One is to write conclusion first and then lessons, and that found that it's always better having a conclusion than immediately the lesson, you know. And so I try to draw more generic, more universal lessons which we can learn from particular event, you know, in that operation, you know. Okay. Okay. You know, this sentence, you know, that very often in decision making by commanders, you know, they rely on enemy's intentions, you know, and that's very, very basic. Generally, unless you know for sure that what intentions are. In this case, we knew, okay, but if we didn't, then it's always better to rely on enemy capability, what enemy is physically capable of doing, okay. That's important for me, you see. Okay. And that's now lesson learned, okay. Okay. And so on. And that's a constant problem with the Japanese planning, you know, in the Pacific War, in my judgment. Whenever they had a major force, superiority forces, they unnecessarily complicated the plans, and they have too many forces, fragmented, and so on. And then another problem for them was that very often they will not take into account what enemy can do. It was given that whatever they do, enemy will not actually react, you know. And that was constant problem, you know, in all this Coral Sea, Midway, and the Philippine Sea, okay. Okay, so I have only a few things here, you know, I will talk about. These were the Japanese objectives, you know, which I have summarized. The main objective was operational, that means capturing Port Moresby in today's Papua New Guinea, then capture Tulagi, that's Lower Solomons, and to establish the seaplane base, and then capture Des Moines Islands, that's in Louisiana, that's also seaplane base, and then Samurai, that's in southeastern tip of New Guinea. The reason why they needed a seaplane base, as we know, that Japanese Navy, like U.S. Navy today, was too offensively minded. And so pilots never liked reconnaissance, scouting. They always thought this is not really a job for fighter pilots. So as a result of that, they didn't have more than three or four reconnaissance squadrons during the war. So they rely on establishing seaplane bases, you know, along the projected line of advance, you know. So that's the reason why that, but also that shows you that many of these objectives they had to take simultaneously, that they require fragmenting available strength, you know, into number of the force elements. Actually for the Port Moresby, they have six force elements which have been moving from Rabaul and Truk, that's the Central Carolines, all the way toward the southern part of the Coral Sea and also Port Moresby. And I have here, this is what I draw, you know, when we teach operational art, you know, we try to provide this broader, what we call in our terms, concepts of operations or operational idea. So what I have drawn here is to, based on the plans with by Japanese, to depict that planning, you know, on the map, okay? And you can see that how many from Rabaul, how many of these elements has to move, and then you have the carrier force was here, okay? And they was planning, they planned initially to bomb some bases, you know, on the northeastern coast of Australia that abandoned. But one among many things, you know, what they made major mistake, there was one, the carrier forces were tasked to ferry about 18 Zero fighters. And these Zero fighters were supposed to be launched, you know, and then landed to the bow. And that was supposed to be an easy task, but then was a bad weather, so they tried to do this, or I think on three occasions, three times. They lost valuable time, then synchronization movement so with other forces was lost. And so when we attacked, our carriers attacked Guadalcanal Tulagi, their carriers were beyond the range or the supporting range of Tulagi. And that was all given because the secondary objective became a primary objective, you know. We always warn, you know, to focus on primary objective, you know, and not to be sidetracked, you know, with, you know, other objectives, you know. Okay. Let me see. I don't know what. Okay. And this is about, this is very complex, you know, I will not bother you at all. You know, this is a depiction of the movements of forces over several days, you know, okay. And you know the results, I will show you, that's a Lexington. Okay, our carrier. And these are the losses, you see, on left side, Japanese side, allies. And what we call in operational terms, we had achieved tactical victory. The Japanese achieved tactical victory, we achieved operational victory. Why? Because in the aftermath of the battle, Admiral Inui, he intuitively knew that the remaining force was not sufficient to provide sustained support to the landing forces in Port Moresby. They were able to continue to Port Moresby, but they will not be able to sustain because they had only one carrier. Another carrier was heavily damaged, has to go to Japan, and also they have depleted, you know, the number of the fighter aircraft. So he wisely decided that operation has to be cancelled, you know, and then decided initially to repeat the operation on 3rd July. And then after Battle of Midway, which was in June, you know, that was certainly not possible. They decided to try to seize Port Moresby over Owen Stanley Mountains. And that never happened because of strong defenses, you know, so they never reached Port Moresby. Okay, so that was operational victory for the Allies and a tactical victory for the Japanese. Okay. And then Midway, you are all familiar, we'll not really go into details, I will just on the objectives, you see, again, was the operational objective, looting and destroying enemy carriers, because Japanese Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, who was the chief or the commander-in-chief of the combined fleet, he believed that, if we're setting it correctly, that if Japan doesn't end war very soon, within a year, then industrial might of the United States will prevail. So that he wants to complete the defeat of the U.S. Pacific Fleet. And the reason why they choose Midway, they thought that that would trigger our, you know, the Pacific Fleet to react, you know. What they didn't consider that our reaction would come earlier, you know, that we will be positioned and waiting on them. They thought that will happen after they capture Midway and then our carriers will come. But because of our knowledge or intelligence, we were able to position these forces much, you know, timely, okay? And then, you know, this was another mistake on the part of Japanese, because the reason for that was not Yamamoto, but the Japanese Naval General Staff, that was a Navy section of the Imperial General Headquarters, they have been on good terms with the Army General Staff, and the Army wanted to seize some positions in the Aleutians in order to prevent bombing of the Kyrgyz and Hokkaido, and also they were hoping to cut off the lines of communication between the United States and Soviet Union. So they insisted that that operation should also include Aleutian phase. And that is one, in operational terms, one big mistake, because they fragmented the strength. They have what we call eccentric double operation. The two operations at the same time, you know, in different parts of the theater. I will show you the map. And then, you know, some of the occupation of Adak Atu and Kiska, okay, and then destroying enemy ships and shore installations in Dutch Harbor, okay. Okay, this was the search plan or movement of forces. And that's one reason that shows you that this is not a, what we call Battle of Midway. That's a major operation, because when you see how many forces were involved here, almost entire combined fleet was actually the size of the combined fleet was double of the forces we had. Okay? And this is the deployment phase, you see. The red, the Japanese, these are blues, United States, okay. And this is an operational scheme which was based on the Japanese documents, okay. Everything was subordinate to N-Day. N-Day was the 5th and 6th June, capture Midway. So all these other dates were coordinated with that. And one major mistake was the what Miyamoto has done, that he insisted that this operation cannot be delayed. You know, the, many of the subordinate commanders were asking that to give more time for training and preparation, because, as you know, in the aftermath of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, the Nagumo's carrier force was extensively used in support of Operation Southern Pacific, and also they had foray in Bay of Bengal, attack on Ceylon or Sri Lanka, and so on. So they barely came at the beginning of May back home, and they needed some time to, you know, reorganize, you know, and to be prepared. But the reason was here tactical. The Midway was a subordinate objective, okay, and then everything was based on phase of moon and tides and currents. So they said if they had to delay until the end of June, by that time maybe act, you know, factor of surprise will be lost and so on. So he insisted that the operation must go as originally planned. Okay, and then this is the occupation, you know, this in the Aleutians. Okay. Okay. So these are main events. You know the many events here. I selected the 4th June, and that's a really momentous decision by the Spruance, because Spruance really made a bold, with a very high risk. Because he launched, decided to launch all-out attack, you know, at almost extreme range, you know, of the, our aircraft, you know, toward to the Japanese. Okay, so if that failed, you know, then his force would have been exposed, you know, to be defeated, you know. So these, I see the some of the events here, the launching of our attack, you know. Then, as you know, we have a two task force, you know. The one was the Enterprise and Hornet. The Task Force 16 and Task Force 17 was Yorktown under Admiral Fletcher, and the Spruance was in charge of Task Force 16. Okay, and then you see Nagumo, and that one of the major men, or the major error Nagumo here made, you know, he wanted to wait until all the aircraft are rearmed. That would take almost like a 10-30. Okay, and advised by Admiral Yamaguchi, who was one of the youngest and very aggressive admirals, to launch immediate attack, he rejected, you know. And the result of that wait is, you know, we had the attack by our torpedo bombers, you know, most of them were shut down, but they also helped the attack of dive bombers, because, I mean, dive bombers, because when the dive bombers came, the Japanese Zero fighters were too low. They were not able to gain altitude, you know, and as a result, we have been lucky. You know, within a few minutes, you know, we hit three carriers. Later during the day, another carrier was sunk. So four carriers, that what we call, in operational terms, operational center of gravity of the Japanese fleet, had been destroyed, okay? And that resolved the whole, you know, issue of the or the Battle of Midway. Okay, that's here to you. Okay. And that's a graphic presentation of that phase on the 4th June. Okay. And that's Aleutian phase, okay. So I will not go into details, you know. And then I have this, it's a losses, you see. Okay. And that signifies the turn of the tide in the Pacific. In strategic terms, the Japanese went on strategic defensive, and we went on strategic offensive, which was then exemplified, you know, with our landing in Guadalcanal on 7 August 1942. And after, you know, after the end of the war, we have been constantly on offensive. The Japanese were never able to regain their balance, you know. Okay. And then you have Japanese Argo operation, you know, and we call this Battle of the Philippine Sea. I personally, when I wrote this, I had major problem actually. A lot of time spent on this, you know. And one thing which I have been somehow buffered with reading other authors, you know, especially second, there were always claims laid that there was not enough information, that we, in contrast to Midway, we didn't know much about that. And that's actually not true, okay? We have a steady stream of documents from radio intercepts and also excellent service by our submarines, which were positioned, you know, nearby the basing area of the Japanese fleet in the Philippines. Okay. So I will focus only on Admiral Spruland's decision, you know, 1819. You know, that's when he decided to stay near Saipan. Okay. And then he got the one message later by Admiral Nimitz, which should actually force, you know, somehow convince him to change the decision. Admiral Mitchell was, you know, very unhappy, but he wanted us, you know, Spruance to change the decision and go westward, you know, and to launch an attack by 050. And in 38 minutes after the Midway, he finally said no, he would stay nearby Sat. And that decision has, caused a lot of controversy, you know, at that time especially, but both Nimitz and Admiral King approved the decision and they thought that he had done a proper thing, you know, okay. My reading on that was a different solution would have been better actually, because, you know, the reason why he wanted to stay in Japan, nearby Saipan, because his primary objective was to protect the shipping, you know, and the troops on the ground. But he also feared that the attack from the flanks, you know, that he might be bypassed, you know, and then Japanese might sneak in and attack forces, you know, nearby. So what he wanted to do is to, during daylight, operating west of Saipan, and then, you know, moving back during the night back forward. Problem was wind, you know, because if you are going westward, you cannot launch the aircraft because the prevailing wind was from east, you know. So in order to close the distance, you know, he has to go, you know, westward, and he refused to do that, you know. There were some also beliefs, you know, that some of the people who were Marine generals, you know, on the Saipan, that they really didn't need a Task Force 58 to protect. They have a sufficient troops, you know, on the ground, and the transports that were able to withdraw east of Saipan, stay out of with any possible attack, you know, and then after the naval battle was completed, you know, then come to the same position, you know. So I cannot tell you what is right, was it wrong, you know. There are a lot of things in favor of the the Spruance decision, but I think still that Spruance had been too somehow conservative, you know, conservative, was too prudent, you know. And he has done very similar thing in our invasion of the Gilberts in November 1943, where he didn't allow the Task Force 58, you know, to operate freely, and we lost one carrier, and he didn't allow them. So, this was not a situation for the carrier force to be so tied to the beaches, you know, that they need to operate much more freely, you know, okay. So there's a matter of judgment, you know, whether that was correct. I mean, he didn't risk anything, but let's say if he really went after the Japanese force, maybe war would have been shortened. Because as you know, as a result of that, we have to wait, and we had to absorb their attack. And we were lucky that our pilots were excellent. But if Japanese pilots were much better, we would probably suffer many losses, you know. Okay. Let me see here, and then I have these are losses, you see. But you see, six carriers survived. Now, without pilots. The pilots, you know, the losses of pilots were enormous, you know. Japanese were never able to regain, tempo, you know, because our operation tempo in Pacific was so fast, they were never having enough time to train the pilots, you know. And, you know, the one problem with the Japanese training was that they would keep their best pilots almost all until the end, you know, so they were treated at a very heavy rate. And we have, due to Admiral Towers, you know, a better system where best pilots were being used for training, you know, and so on. So we have always steady, influx of the good pilots, you know, to our carrier forces, you know. So that's all, and I think three fleet, they were all sunk by submarines. I think submarines have done a great, I would say, that their service has not been sufficiently recognized in this operation, both in terms of detecting the movements of the Japanese forces and also in destroying, you know, all these three carriers, you know. Okay, so that's a, okay. Okay, this is a, I will not go into, I mean, I think sequence for this, you know, the major operation in the European waters, you know, that should be done this year, you know, so that, that we completed these two volumes, you know, the study of major naval operations, you know, so, okay. So that's all what I have to say. I know it's fast, you know, but I think 30 minutes is good. I told John Hutton, though, I cannot stand people with foreign accent to listen to them, you know, so you know, I should not be better, you know. Okay. I like American accent, you know. Yes. Yeah.
Talking about the Battle of the Philippine Sea, you didn't mention Admiral
Halsey. Yeah.
Admiral Halsey.
Well, Admiral Halsey was not here in the Philippine Sea.
Yeah,
it was Admiral Spruance, Task Force 58.
Okay, so I guess I'm thinking of an earlier battle.
No, no, in the Battle of Philippine Sea,
where are you?
Battle of Philippine Sea, he was not there because he was, you know, we alternated, you know, Task Force 58, Task Force 38. And also he was supposed to be in command for Midway, but he, you know, fell ill. And then as a replacement came Admiral Spruance, and that was a great choice, you know.
Right.
You know, and Admiral Spruance proved extremely, and we had also excellent Admiral Fletcher, who essentially allowed Spruance to operate, you know, without being, you know, holding him rigidly, because he was a senior admiral, Fletcher, you know. And as you know, the Spruance was a surface officer, you know, he was not a carrier pilot, you know. Yeah.
The Battle of Midway, you indicated in your timing the torpedo planes, of course, came in first and were largely destroyed. However, the fortuitous placement of the gun alignment, which then kept the dive bombers able to get in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did we anticipate that, or was that just fortuitous situation?
Well, I would say that lack of coordination was a good thing. We usually try, the dive bomber, torpedo bomber should come. No, seriously, in this instance, the lack of coordination was actually a good thing. Okay, even though they attack only a few minutes after the last attack by torpedo bomber. As you know, all torpedo bombers, essentially, except few, they were all shut down. Okay.
Yes.
So sometimes, you know, lack of good planning may be a good thing, you know, you never know. But I will still argue you should always try well and not rely on the events, you know, and which are unforeseen, okay? I mean, we don't know that, you know, and, but you know, if Nagumo, he had four carriers, you know, against three, if he was more aggressive, you know, as Admiral Yamaguchi was, you know, maybe outcome would have been different. And you know, the one I didn't discuss because there are so many things to discuss, you know, that if they planned properly, they planned that these operations, you know, in very quick sequence. For example, Coral Sea took place in the, you know, 10, 11 May. And so, because these two carriers, you know, the Zuikaku, Shokaku, one of them was heavily damaged. If they were not sent, let's say the operation took place much earlier, maybe these two carriers would be available for the Midway operation. So instead of four, he would have six carriers. And no, I don't want to go in revisionist history, but probably chances of their success would have been greater. You know, I don't know that, you know, okay? The same thing, we have made a mistake in a Coral Sea. I don't know the... In terms of command relationships, you know, we didn't have a really very good relationship. You know, Admiral Nimitz was a commander-in-chief of Pacific Ocean Area, and he was commander of the Pacific Fleet. As a Singapore, he was under Joint Staff, you know, Joint Chief of Staff. Under as a commander of Pacific Fleet, he was directly under Admiral King. And Admiral King actually was much influential in deciding movement of forces. So he, in his planets in Washington, decided early 1942, in order to raise morale, to have a Task Force 16, which was under Halsey, you know, two carriers to put, you know, B-25 bombers, you know, and then bomb Tokyo and so on. But that was beneficial for us in terms of morale, but it affected our operations in southern Pacific, because these two carriers were not available for the battle in the Coral Sea. So if we had, let's say, four carriers versus two carriers against Japanese two carriers, probably our victory would have been much more decisive. So it also shows you how, you know, I personally think that the Admiral King made a mistake. You know, I don't want to be too harsh, you know, but, you know, sometimes people don't know what is going on. But both King and Nimitz, others, they knew what the Japanese were planning, you know, in Southern Pacific. And I think it was a mistake at that particular time, you know, to move these carriers up north, you know, and not to make them, you know, available in the Southern Pacific. I mean, I'm a great admirer of King, you know, and especially Spruance, so don't put me in the, don't think wrong, you know, but, you know, we also try as historians, you know, or so-called historians, we try to, you know, to somehow give some judgment, you know, based on logic and what was, but I think, you know, when you know what they knew at that time, that's how, the only way you can actually evaluate whether their decisions were sound or they were unsound. Yeah.
So if I understand you right, you're saying breaking the code was main key to the victories?
Well, I would say no. You know, I say what reading the code, we knew their intentions and their movement, their forces, and when you have a small force, inadequate forces, you cannot make a mistake in, you know, poor disposition of your forces. So we have been able to put these forces in proper time, proper place, but it still depends on the quality of your pilots and your commanders to win the victory. You know, the intelligence itself is never enough, you know. And another thing is, I didn't talk about controversy prior to Midway, you know, where the Admiral Nimitz had a great confidence into, you know, with his intelligence officers, you know. If Admiral Nimitz was a different person, very often, you know, commanders play a role of being their own intelligence officer, we will probably not be able to, to march these forces in nearby Midway timely. Because at the same time, the people who are in Washington, OP-20G, they believe that the next attack by Japanese will be West Coast or Samoa. And the Rochefort and Layton were firmly convinced there will be a Midway. And, you know, they used one, they didn't know there was, you know, the Japanese will use certain abbreviations for various geographic places. So AF was actually Midway. And they thought AF is Midway, but the others were disagreements. So what they did, they sent the convinced Nimitz to send an uncoded message that some of water installations on Midway need to be repaired and so on. So then they were following what the Japanese reaction was, and then they were able to find out that Japanese actually thought AF is a Midway. Later, that abbreviation was changed to MI, okay? But that was what, and then, you know, Admiral King was also making another mistake. He, after moving Task Force 16 from the Central Pacific, he moved two of them, Halsey, to Southern Pacific. Mm-hmm. And Admiral Nimitz has to fight these things, you know. Admiral Nimitz actually made decision of his own and saying that, to withdraw these forces and go back so they can timely be, you know, massed off Midway. And he calculated if he made a mistake, then King will reverse the decision. And that didn't happen, you know, so that these two carriers were then available. If we have only one carrier, in Midway, we will probably not be successful, certainly, you know. And Yorktown, as you know, suffered damages here, and it was calculated that it would take about 90 days. And when they came, you know, to the yard, you know, dockyard in harbor, the Nimitz requested 3 days. And so that's the reason why Yorktown then became available, okay? So a lot of things have been happening. So I'm not, if I give you the impression that is everything intelligence, no, it's not, you know, but certainly it's helpful, okay? I mean, you know, so, yeah.
Did they ever use U.S. submarines in accompaniment of these carrier task forces?
Well, what submarines were helpful, they were properly positioned, you know, in Yolo, Tavi, you know, which was main Anchorage and Davao and so on. So they were monitoring and they were able to report timely when the fleet went out. That was not obtained. You see, the problem with, I certainly have time to go into the Japanese way of doing the things. The reason why we were reading these messages was because of the messages transmitted by shore commands to the, but once the fleet was out, there was a total radio silence. So we were not able to read anything. Sometimes, you know, I remember when I wrote a book on Leyte, we were able to get information on whereabouts of the striking forces because there were messages sent to supply ships. And then, you know, supply ships, you know, that we know they were following these forces, so we were able to somehow deduce where these forces are. So it was total radio silence, you know. And, you know, what was also very beneficial, especially in submarine warfare, that we knew known positions of the convoys and so on, we knew also what they call battle damage assessment. You know, when Commodore would then report to the shore command in Japan how many ships were sunk or damaged and so on, we knew all these things, you know. It was a great, great help, you know. But again, if Japanese were not so convinced in that their codes are unbreakable, that was also potentially cause of the problems, you know. Okay, the same thing, the same lesson also applies today. Okay.
Now, who did Admiral Spruance report to?
Admiral Spruance was subordinate to Nimitz, because he was Nimitz was a U.S. Pacific Fleet commander. Okay. Okay, and Nimitz reported both to Joint Staff and to King. Okay. But admirals were, you know, I'm a great admirer of Admiral Spruance and Nimitz and King, you know, despite their reputation in some quarters and so on, they were all school, you know, admirals who actually allow a lot of initiative on the part of the subordinates. Okay, they were not shy to replace somebody who was not effective, but they let the subordinates to command. And that's what our admirals today have to remember. Okay, micromanagement, too much micromanagement, okay?
One thing.
Yeah.
I broke in under a German chief engineer in the merchant marine.
Yeah.
You sound just like him.
Okay, thanks. I guess that's a compliment, you know. Okay. Okay, thanks, yeah. Yeah.
Did MacArthur have any influence on these operations that you described?
Well, it has an influence, you know, in the Coral Sea, and as you know, in those days we didn't have. My book talks about command relationships and how it was established. The Coral Sea was in the area, Southwest Pacific area, so he was nominally in charge of that area, and we had, as you know, the Pacific Ocean area was divided by the Joint Staff into what we call today four theater operations. You know, it was a North Pacific, Central Pacific, Southern, and was a South East Pacific, which we don't hear much. That's off the coast of Chile. But in terms of South Pacific, the Admiral Gormlich, who became SOPAC, the commander, he was in May, still not there. He didn't come until June. Okay, so what we had a problem in Pacific, first there are overlapping area between two theater commanders, and another one was that we didn't have any intermediate commander between Nimitz and Task Force 17. So that was a problem, you know, because then you have a one intermediate level less, you know. Okay, so we always say you should have not too many levels and you should not have too few, okay? But you know, this is not to be critical, because this is the first time we have been in a global war. We have been trying to get these things done, you know, and so on. And so they improved these things later on. The boundary between Southwest Pacific area and Southern Pacific was moved, you know, and so on. But it has effect here, because the land-based aircraft were used for search, you know, in Coral Sea, but there was lack of coordination, because there was not a good coordination between two commands, you know. Okay. A problem with MacArthur was at that time too much chatter between pilots, you know, so Nimitz has to send him a message, you know, prior to the Midway, you know, to be beware of the radio security, you know, okay, too much talk, you know, between pilots, you know, okay. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Just a question with regard to the Aleutian campaign. Seems
which
to be
Aleutian, yeah.
The Aleutian campaigns, I thought, was planned by the Japanese to some extent as a diversion from the Midway operation.
Yeah.
Is that?
It was not diversion. No, I don't think it was planned as diversion. It was planned to seize Kiska, Attu, and Adak. You know, and also destroy installations in the Dutch harbor. And they wanted to prevent our land-based long-range bombers to bomb Hokkaido and Kuris. It was a compromise, because in order to get approval by Naval General Staff and Army for the Midway, they had to make compromises. And that's why Yamamoto agreed, but I think it was a mistake, because a lot of forces were assigned to that, you know, and that these forces were not available to other. To the main objective, you know, and so on. The army was happy with Midway because they didn't have there was no need by the Navy to give them any troops. There were only a few troops for the special forces of Midway, nothing else, you know. And the Naval General Staff was more interested to go in July, since their plan was if Midway was completed successfully, the next phase of expansion would be Southern Pacific. That means attacking, you know, Samoa, Fiji, you know, and the strong points in Southern Pacific. When I was, researching for the situation up in the prior to Coral Sea, the Naval General Staff was pushing to invade Australia. You know, that was shortly after the, invasion of Netherlands East Indies and so on. They thought the next step should be Australia. But the Army was strongly opposed, because out of 51 division, 11 divisions were committed to the operations in the Pacific. All others were in Manchuria and China, and for home islands. So they didn't want any more, divisions to be assigned. You know, they calculated 250,000 troops, and so on. So as a compromise for that between Naval General Staff and the Army, decision was made then to go and to, seize the New Caledonia, Samoa, and Fiji, okay? So I think one problem here is, which I didn't have time to discuss, Yamamoto was very influential, too influential, and that he essentially undermined strategy, because he was driving the strategy as an operational commander instead of Naval General Staff. So never, and he, and any time, especially for Midway, he threatened, to resign if his wishes are not followed. So I was great admirer of Admiral Yamamoto prior to my study, not today, but I thought he was a great commander in a way, but also I think too tactically oriented, I think, in my judgment, okay? But that doesn't matter. I mean, who cares what I think, okay?
thank you.
Yeah, okay.
When did the amphibious landings that we participated in occur in that area?
In Southern Pacific, 7 August 1942. That was our first landing in the Southern Pacific. And that was beginning of the offensive phase of our advance in the Pacific. 7 August 1942.
Interesting.
This is also one interesting stuff, because, aftermath of Midway, we have to exploit victory of Midway. We call this operation success. If we wait too long, the Japanese will recover. So we had to move, it's really due to Admiral King. Admiral King single-handedly almost forced the decision that has to be done soon, rather than to wait, and so on. And but we didn't have sufficient forces. We have also to deal with a strong Japanese resistance. And so we landed successfully on Guadalcanal, but we had to fight almost 7 months of attrition warfare to consolidate our gains of the, because the strong Japanese, resistance, especially at sea. Okay, during the whole, Solomon's campaign, we had 15 naval battles, and we lost, there was draw 12. And all due to the poor state of our night fighting capabilities and the torpedo gunnery tactics, So this is very interesting to read, because Japanese, in the pre-war years, they believed that any new war they will deal with the Britain and United States. So to redress that, imbalance in numbers, they intensified night training and torpedo gunnery tactics and so on, and also tried to build better, more modern ships and so on. And the reason for that was that is a strategic, because there was a in Washington Naval Conference in 1922, they didn't get a parity in forces with Britain, you know, so they were very unhappy. And so they tried to redress this issue, you know, with and I think starting 1927, all the way to the war and so on, they have intensified training. And training was so realistic, you know, many times ships were almost collided. One, I think, destroyer was sunk in 1927. They trained mostly in Northern Pacific, and U.S. Navy trained in Caribbean, okay? So, and you know, that what I always want here, you know, that this kind of errors in peacetime, you know, are very difficult to, you know, redress, you know, once the war starts. We never really reached the level, satisfactory level on night fighting, you know, in the Pacific War. I didn't have a chance to discuss the issue. I think it was on 18 June during the Battle of Philippine Sea. Admiral Mitchell, he wanted to use the battle line, the Willis Lee battle line, which was specially established, you know, for night fighting, to go, you know, in the night, you know, and to pursue Japanese. And Spruance and Willis Lee would not do it because we didn't feel confident that we can win that kind of, you know. What my lesson is here, the errors you do in terms of not realistic training or reducing training and education standards, you are going to pay later on in war, okay? So that's what we always say, operational lessons learned, you know, or identified, okay?
In that context, were the Japanese effective? When were the Japanese effective with the use of radar? Or were they?
What they had, you know, in the Solomons, they had better radar detectors. And radar detectors were able to detect our ships at longer range than what we were able to detect them. As you know, Japanese had excellent optics. You know, many times, you know, especially Battle of Savo on 7-8 August, you know, they have been much better. Actually, their ships detected our ships, even though our picket destroyers had a radar, they were not able to detect them. You know, the Japanese had done some very good things, you know, if you look, you know, in torpedo gunnery, in that use of cruisers and destroyers, they were unmatched, you know. And the U.S. Navy made a big mistake in, I think, mid-1930s when they decided to remove all torpedo tubes from cruisers. And Japanese didn't. Another thing was a Japanese advantage was that many of their modern destroyers had reload capabilities. That in other words, after they launched torpedoes, they withdrew, and after 18, 20 minutes, they would come back and relaunch the attack, you know. And we didn't have this kind of capability. Plus, there are long lance torpedo, 24 inches. You know, even though it was designed, I think, 1933, we didn't have any inkling, our intelligence, about that torpedo. Okay, so there are many things, you know, that these are technical, you know. But one thing I always found, especially in the fightings in Solomons, both sides were in dark about their successes. They're all exaggerated successes. You know, we thought we are doing well in night fighting, so we didn't need to improve, you know. And they think that they're sinking more ships, you know, when they're actually losing, you know. And then they put more and more ships in, you know, and then in the end, you know, they were not able to outproduce us, you know, they had to give up, okay.
Our own.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
When did these ships get radar? You were late in the war getting radar.
No, we got radars before the war.
Before the war?
Before the war, yeah. Oh. A Japanese got it during the war, Japanese. But at the beginning they have radar detector can actually detect you a longer range than the radar can detect, you know, so, yeah. Okay. Okay. If you don't have any questions, I will be happy to escape, you know.
Milan's book is published by the Naval War College Press, but available only through government printing office, so you can get it online. We're not able to sell these things on campus for some reason, the way the laws are, but thank you, Milan.
Okay, thanks, yeah.